Welcome to Louisiana College. If you're visiting our campus, we welcome you to an institution that's grounded in the preeminence of Jesus Christ, the authority of the Holy Scriptures, the Bible, academic excellence, and a passion for changing the world for Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. We stand upon those truths. We're a religious institution who is grounded in these educational and biblical principles, and we welcome each and every one of you. Former Speaker of the House and President Newt Gingrich and his beautiful, wonderful wife, Callista, who are here today in an effort to become the next President and First Lady of the United States. To the Louisiana College students, I want you to remember this day in history. Thank you for your allegiance to the respect and dignity we owe this couple who are risking all to be the leaders of this country. So in so doing, we want to give a Louisiana College welcome, first of all, who will introduce her husband, the next First Lady of the United States, Ms. Callista Gingrich.
Sing a song about the heartland.
That kind introduction and warm welcome. It's great to be with you in Pineville this morning. Newt and I are engaged in this race because we believe America is at a crossroads and care deeply about the future of our country. There are only a few months left before the most important election in our lifetime. Our only opponent is Barack Obama, and we are committed to removing him from the White House. Newt is the only candidate with the experience and knowledge necessary to rebuild the America we love. He has a successful national record of creating jobs, balancing the budget, and reforming our government. Today, we need a leader who can clearly articulate why President Obama and his policies are wrong for America. We need a leader who understands that we must contain and defeat our enemies. And we need a leader with bold solutions to create a better future for all Americans. I believe that leader is my husband. Please welcome former Speaker of the House and the next President of the United States, Newt Gingrich.
First of all, Clissa and I are just thrilled to be here with all of you, and we really appreciate Louisiana College offering this opportunity to talk about liberty and to talk about key issues in American life. I can't imagine a more appropriate place to talk about what I think a fundamental threat the Obama ideology is to this country. And it's not about Barack Obama himself. He simply is the clearest vision of a left which has been growing for at least a half century. And it's a vision which is in our courts, it's in our bureaucracies, it's in our elite media, it's in all too much of our academic world. And it's a vision which fundamentally challenges the very nature of America. This was a country built by people who would have felt very comfortable here at Louisiana College. It's a country built by people who signed a Declaration of Independence which was based on truth. If you read the opening sentence, we hold these truths to be self-evident. Wasn't an effort at moral confusion, wasn't an effort at situation ethics, wasn't a theoretical possibility based on a philosophy. They were trying to understand what is the truth by which people live. They went on to say that we're all created equal, which in 1776 was an astonishingly radical position. Remember, that's a time of kings, monarchs, czars, emperors, and yet they were saying, right straight at George III, we're all equal. fundamentally violating the structure of European civilization. Now, we didn't live up to it at first. We had slavery. Certainly, women had secondary roles. But we've spent 225 years now working towards this model. And we've succeeded to a point where you can come from anywhere in the world and you can learn to be an American. And in almost every case, you'll have greater opportunity here than you had back home. And that's not just true in terms of people from poor countries. Arnold Schwarzenegger, who was a bodybuilder in a small town in Austria, would never have become president of Austria, would never become a multimillionaire, but he could come to America. You know, he could sort of come close to mastering English. He could become very wealthy as a movie star, even wealthier as a real estate investor, governor of our largest state. I mean, just think about that kind of opportunity. And so you see people from everywhere come here, not because you and I are exceptional, but because the system we've inherited is exceptional. And that's what American exceptionalism is all about. And why is it exceptional? Well, the next sentence in the Declaration captures it perfectly. We are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, this is central to understanding America. We are the only society in history that says power comes from God to each one of you personally. You are personally sovereign. You then loan power to the government, which is why our Constitution begins, "We the people." Now, this is central to understanding America, and it's something which I think Obama totally misunderstands. It comes out of a European model. In the American model, you are always a citizen, and the government is supposed to be your servant. In the European model, you are a subject, and you are a servant to the government. And if you'll notice, for example, what's happening in Greece, they're basically being ordered to lower their standard of living by 35%. Because government believes it has the right to issue orders. In America, that would lead to an all-out explosion and an election in which everybody doing the ordering got fired. Because we're a country that believes if you're not serving the people ought to get rid of you. Fundamentally different model. And what you see happening with things like Obamacare, things like the Dodd-Frank bill, is you see a centralization of power away from you. So you become less and less free. You have fewer and fewer choices. And that's the heart of the left's model. The left's model essentially is that a group of very smart people at the center will decide life for the rest of us because we're not smart enough to decide for ourselves. So they'll take care of us. And in the long run, it has really frightening implications. If you get a chance, all of you should look sometime at George Orwell's 1984. Which is a novel about a totalitarian state which does not take place in Russia. It's not about Moscow. It's about London. Orwell was a socialist. I mean, he really believes a very left-wing intellectual. But he came to the conclusion that centralized government planning led to dictatorship because it kept putting more and more and more power at the center. And then, in order to defend the dictatorship, they had to control what you're allowed to say. Calista and I had the wonderful experience of making a movie about Pope John Paul II called 9 Days That Changed the World. In 1979, the Pope goes back to Poland, the first Polish Pope in history, and he arouses the Polish people. The opening morning, he's in Warsaw, and 3 million people show up for Mass. And they look at each other, as some of them said in our movie, and they suddenly realize that there were more of us than there were of the communists. And from that point on, they're in a power struggle with the dictatorship. And we have a copy in our office of an original poster from Solidarity. Solidarity was the union that was formed to take on the communists. And they had a poster that says in Polish, "For Poland to remain Poland, 2 plus 2 must always equal 4. And that comes from the concept that if the state can tell you 2 plus 2 equals 5, and this is in Orwell, or Orwell has the torturer say to the innocent citizen, if we tell you it's 5, it's 5. If we tell you it's 3, it's 3. And the citizen's thinking, well, what if it's actually 4? But frankly, he's in the process of being tortured, and he decides, okay, he'll go along, giving up, in a sense, his soul in order to avoid the pain. Now, this is also described in Camus' novel, The Plague, in which Camus says, there are times when a man can be killed for saying 2 + 2 = 4 because the authorities can't stand the truth. Abraham Lincoln described it differently. Lincoln said one time, you can never win a debate with a man who won't concede that 2 + 2 = 4 because facts will make no difference. And so you can't win. Now, I'm going to give you a couple quick examples in terms of the Obama administration. The Obamacare attack on religious liberty in its war against right-to-life beliefs is an absolute, total violation of the First Amendment to the Constitution. And I want you to think about the Obama administration. Here's an administration which apologizes to radical Islamist fanatics who are killing young Americans while it is waging war against the Catholic Church in the United States and against every Baptist and every other institution that is dedicated to right to life. So you have this president who, on the one hand, has bent over backwards to appease radical Islam while he attacks Christianity. And there's no other way to describe it. It is a fact. In fact, it's fascinating to me, the administration after the Quran incident. Remember, the Quran incident was caused by Muslim political prisoners who were writing in the Quran and defacing it to use it to send messages. So all this blame against us started with Muslim extremists misusing their own book, which we're told we should respect even though we're not Muslim, while they weren't respecting it even though they are Muslim. That's a little bit of a bizarre double standard in my mind. But it gets worse than this. The administration's now put out that our policy, the perfectly Obama-like language, items that are held sacred by others, we will hold sacred. That's supposedly, I assume, refers to the Quran. My position is simple. This is terrific. Every Christian group in America should say, what a great policy. Does this mean we can put crosses back up? Does this mean we put the Ten Commandments back up? Are you willing to apply in the United States the rules you're prepared to apply in Afghanistan? And then watch them start to backpedal. Because, of course, they're not. Because they're anti-religious unless it's Islam. And this is the heart of the Obama problem, the dilemma he has. So a Moroccan man is arrested 3 weeks ago trying to bomb the U.S. Capitol. Under the Obama administration's rules, the FBI cannot explain what motivates him. Very, very important thing to remember. Cliss and I did a movie, America at Risk, in which we have the killer in Fort Hood. An American Army major jumps up. He yells, Allahu Akbar. He kills 13. He wounds 33. He's carrying a card in his wallet that says, Soldier of Allah. He has been in touch with a cleric in Yemen who wants Americans to kill other Americans. This is a cleric who Obama did correctly kill. Even though he was an American, because he was waging war in the United States. And when you wage war in the United States, you give up all of your civil liberties and you become an enemy. And people need to understand this. This is not a game. This is not an ACLU exercise. Now, the Army, to its institutional disgrace, wrote a report on this major that never deals with Islam once. Now, how do you explain yelling Allahu Akbar? How do you explain carrying a card that says Soldier of Allah? How do you explain constantly emailing back and forth to a cleric in Yemen? Here's what they're doing. They are reducing fanaticism to psychotic behavior. Why do you think the Moroccan man was trying to blow up the Capitol? Maybe he has a fixation on the Capitol. Maybe he's mad at America for something. I wonder what he could be mad about. Now, to show you how sick it is, and it's much deeper than just Obama. A Pakistani man comes to the U.S., gets his citizenship, goes back home, takes his family with him, takes a 2-week training course on how to make car bombs, comes back by himself, builds a car bomb, does it badly, puts it in Times Square, and after all the money we have spent on national security, all the money we've spent on intelligence, all the money we've spent on homeland security, The first warning we get that there's a car bomb in Times Square is when it fails to go off and the car starts to smoke. And a street vendor walks up to a policeman and says, "Don't you think we should investigate the car that's smoking?" Now, I mean, that's what it came down to. A local street vendor and a local cop filled in the gap that had been left by intelligence, national security, and homeland security. Now, they pick up the car bomb. We don't know yet who's done it. Mayor Bloomberg, and this just tells you how terrified the elites are of dealing with reality. Mayor Bloomberg goes on television and says on CBS News, "We should not rush to judgment. We don't know that this was a radical Islamist. This could have been somebody who was against Obamacare." Now, as a historian, I want to report in that in the last decade, there have been thousands of suicide bombs, you know, explosive devices, car bombs, 99-point-something percent from people who are radical Islamists. To the best of my knowledge, and any of you can correct me if I get this wrong, or the fact checkers in the media can correct me, I do not know of a single Obamacare car bomb. I mean, think about how pathetic it is. Here's a billionaire mayor of our biggest city passionately seeking to hide from reality, because if he deals with reality, it'll scare him. And this is your national security crisis. Now, let me show you how that then carries over to energy. Since we're not allowed to worry about our good friends who are trying to kill us, and we're not allowed to think about any strategy that would deal with that reality, the Obama administration last week, finally getting frightened over the price of gasoline, asked the Saudis to increase their oil production. Now, this is strategically destructive on the grand scale. First of all, if you want increased oil production, wouldn't it be a lot better to have it in Louisiana, where it created Louisiana jobs? Second, wouldn't you really want to have, if you're going to have this kind of situation, wouldn't you really want to be in a situation where instead of paying royalties to the Saudi government, the royalties were paid to the American government and the Louisiana state government? And third, don't you want to reduce your dependence on Middle Eastern oil, not increase your dependence, precisely so you can deal with radical Islam? And yet here you have an administration which is so anti-American energy that they first of all spent 2 weeks while we were engaged in a debate with them at long distance over the price of gasoline. And the first week and a half, they attacked me over it. And then I think they began to realize that with gasoline prices going up, they better sound positive. And so their idea of positive, having said that more oil production wouldn't lower prices, they promptly asked the Saudis to increase oil production to lower prices. And this is typical of their confusion. Last year, or the year before, the president went to Brazil. He had closed down new exploration in the Gulf. And by the way, again, in terms of their fundamental intellectual dishonesty, when they raised the moratorium, they replaced it with a permit system, and they don't issue any permits. So there is no moratorium, but you can't drill because you can't get a permit. But the permit system is there, so it's not fair to say there's a moratorium anymore. It's just there's not going to be any real drilling, or it'll take a really long time. And the Washington bureaucrats who are anti-oil will decide when it happens. And that's kind of the game they're playing. So having closed down offshore for Louisiana and Texas, the president goes to Brazil and he says to the Brazilians, "I am really proud that you are developing your offshore oil in the Atlantic. And I'm really glad to say that we can give you a $2 billion loan guarantee to buy more equipment for your offshore development. And I want you to know that I want America to be your best customer." Now, this is exactly backwards. Presidents should not go around the world as purchasing agents for foreign countries. Presidents should go around the world as salesmen for American goods and services, creating jobs in America. But notice the Obama model. The Obama model is to borrow from the Chinese to pay the Brazilians. I mean, somewhere in the middle there, we have to have jobs and we have to work, because we have to both pay off the Chinese and pay off the Brazilians. And it makes you wonder sometimes what country he thinks he's president of. Now, let me take you, because this is going to relate to your generation dramatically. We are at the edge of an extraordinary increase in American energy supplies. Your generation is going to look back on the last 40 years and wonder why people were so pessimistic. And let me explain why. New science and new technology is changing everything. And the fact is that we now have new drilling technologies that have opened up shale in a way we never thought possible. You see it right here in Louisiana in the Shreveport area, where suddenly we have found enormous quantities of natural gas. You're finding it in North Dakota, where we're finding enormous quantities of oil. When I say enormous, we thought in the year 2000 that there were 7 years' supply of natural gas left in the United States, that we were going to have to import liquid natural gas from the Middle East, that the price was going to become so high that the American chemical industry would go offshore. We now have 125 years' supply of natural gas in the United States. The price has collapsed. The chemical industry is coming back, and we're beginning to plan shipping natural gas, liquid natural gas, to China to export it instead of import it. All this has happened in the last 8 years. Even the president, in his energy speeches, admits that we're probably going to create 600,000 new jobs out of natural gas. Now, here's what makes it fascinating. The president decided he had to attack my policy of getting to $2.50 a gallon gasoline and having an American energy plan. And my plan is very simple. I believe we have to be the number one producer of oil in the world, because I want to make sure that no future president ever again bows to a Saudi king. Now, in that setting, the president says, we have this energy problem, but there are no silver bullets. And he likes this phrase. He uses it almost all his speeches. There are no silver bullets. Well, first of all, there is a silver bullet. It's called drilling, and I'll come back to that. But there's also a presidential pen. So just to let you see how rapidly things could develop, the president could sign three documents today. He could approve the Keystone XL pipeline. That would, within a year, bring 700,000 barrels a day from Canada to Houston. It would reduce the cost of bringing oil from North Dakota. It would reduce the cost of bringing oil from Oklahoma, Kansas, Arkansas, and East Texas. And so you'd have more oil at lower cost, and it would come from North America, not from the Middle East. Second, he could open up the areas that are currently closed in the Gulf off Texas and Louisiana. That's about 400,000 barrels a day. Third, he can open up designated areas in Alaska. That's about 1,200,000 barrels a day. So three signatures, 2.3 million barrels a day, over 800 million barrels a year, just in that one step. In addition, he could open up offshore, and he could open up federal land. Remember, you own, the American people, 69% of Alaska. That's 1.5 times the size of Texas. So you start exploring that level. Now, here's what's happened in North Dakota. We've gone from 150 million barrels of reserve to 24 billion barrels of reserve. That's a 160-fold or 16,000% increase. And we believe with the next generation of technology 20 or 30 years from now, we're going to find a total reserve in that range of 500 billion. Now, all of a sudden, virtually everything that Obama believes about oil and gas is backwards. We have huge supplies of oil and natural gas. We're nowhere near what used to be called peak oil. Peak oil was a theory that there was a date where you'd get to half of all the oil in the world, and then after that it would start to decline. It was a big, very, very much believed in by our elites, which made them feel really good about feeling bad. And then that gave them an excuse, because it's an excuse for government to control everything. Since we're all about to run out of oil, I guess the government has to be responsible. And, you know, and it's a very different model. And this is a model that we're struggling with as an American people. Part of that model was, of course, to force us into smaller and smaller and smaller cars. So the president likes the Volt. The Volt gets a $7,500 tax credit if you buy one. The average family that buys one earns $170,000 a year. So everybody who buys a light truck is subsidizing wealthy people to buy an electric car. It is so new as a technology that only 7,500 have been sold, even with a $7,500 thing. And I've tried to explain it psychologically. You can't put a gun rack in a vault. Now, to be honest, there's actually, after I said that a couple of times, there's actually a YouTube video of a guy in Atlanta who owns a vault who put a gun rack in the truck. But a friend of mine from who was a hunter down in Camilla looked at it and he said, yeah, you can get the gun rack in the trunk, but then where do you put the deer? But I'm making, look, I don't care if people buy vaults, that's fine. I don't care if people buy Priuses, that's fine. I don't like the President of the United States thinking it's in his power to dictate to the rest of us what kind of vehicle we ought to drive. His Secretary of Anti-Energy, Dr. Chu, used to say that he was for European-level gasoline prices. That's $9 or $10 a gallon. Last week, he decided under enormous political pressure he didn't mean it. Now, I don't believe him. Their policies are all designed to raise the cost of electricity and raise the cost of gasoline. And so I think we need to replace him. But let me describe again for a minute how silly this is. And again, it gives you a sense of how Obama's mind works. So Obama explains, drilling is not the answer. And he actually goes sort of nutso on this topic. I mean, at one point he said, in effect, Gingrich wants us to drill on the National Mall. Now, I just want you to know I'm making a campaign pledge here this morning. We will not drill on the National Mall. There. Done. Then he said, there are going to be 200 platforms in the Chesapeake Bay. Nobody suggested drilling in Chesapeake Bay. So let's take that off the table. Now you get, how about out in the middle of the Atlantic beyond the sight of land? Or how about out in the middle of the Pacific? Or how about the Chukchi Sea in Alaska, which we believe holds as much oil and gas as the Gulf of Mexico? The president doesn't want to debate those. He wants to make wildly exaggerated statements to make us look like we're extremists. But let me show you how extreme he is. So the president, in his very first energy speech, he never repeated this, but the very first energy speech in Florida, he says, drilling is not the answer. Anybody here know what he said the answer was? How many of you knew it was algae? Raise your hand. Okay. So the president's standing there and he's saying, and he goes on for like, you know, three paragraphs. Algae is part of our future. Now, I got intrigued. My newsletter this week actually is on, I do an electronic newsletter every Wednesday. And the newsletter this week is on algae. Because we went to the Algae Association. That's not its technical name, but the guys who do research in algae. And I said, well, you know, we think in maybe 10 years, we might be able to produce commercially large quantities of petroleum from algae. And we think we could do it for somewhere between $140 and $800 a barrel. Now, that would imply, you know, you're going to pay dramatically more. I mean, nobody's ever calculated $800 a barrel in terms of gasoline prices, but that would probably be like $45 a gallon or $60 a gallon gas. This is like Solyndra. This is one of those, you know, interesting left-wing ideas which works theoretically as long as it's not real. And then you put in $500 million and you go, oh, that didn't quite work. You know, the president complains about the oil industry getting a tax break. The amount of money he wastes on wacky ideas dwarfs the oil industry. And things like Solyndra, they just throw the money away because they're not practical. You know, I cannot get you to go and buy $45 a gallon algae gas. So we're doing a little poster. And over here it has Obama as President Algae. And it says $10 a gallon. Over here is Newt as President Drilling, and it's $2.50 a gallon. And we say, you choose, we have a drilling rig and we have a bottle of algae. And we say, you know, you choose. But just, you know, I'm thinking about getting volunteers this summer to go to gas stations and walk up to people with a bottle of algae and ask them if they'd like an Obama tank of gas. This is the kind of stuff. But here's what made it really intellectually fascinating. It's worth studying by your classes. On this page, he's talking about drilling is not the answer. Literally 2 pages later, he's talking about the breakthroughs in natural gas. And he's correct. They're huge breakthroughs. But here's the question. How have we discovered all the natural gas the president's talking about? Anyone want to guess? Drilling. So here he says, drilling doesn't really work except when it works. And that's why he's wrong. I believe, and I'm going through this at some length because I want you to understand, you are going to inherit a country in which your elites believe in things that aren't true. You're going to inherit a country in which the policies are actually anti-American. And you're going to inherit a country in which, with a little bit of luck, we're going to break loose. There's no reason by the end of this decade that we will not be the most productive country on the planet, with the most modern industry, with the least expensive energy. If you look at the price of natural gas, it has dropped from around $7.97 a unit down to about $2.35 2 days ago. If you had the same drop in the price of gasoline, it would cost $1.13 a gallon. So when I talk about $2.50, I'm being very reasonable in saying there is a trajectory that gets us to a price that enables us to be the most productive country in the world. Let me do this for just a minute. I'd like to take just a couple minutes of questions because I can't, as a former teacher, I can't come to a bunch of students and not give you a chance to ask something. So now we have a microphone over here. So, and another one back there. So if you raise your hand, we'll be glad to give you a chance. Gentleman right here in the red cap.
Mr. Newt, Agenda 21, where do you stand on that? And the lost treaty, the law of the sea treaty, where do you stand on that?
I'm opposed to both. Agenda 21 is part of a United Nations agreement on planning, which has never been ratified by the U.S. Senate. I would issue an executive order on the first day instructing the entire federal government not to implement it in any way. And I think it's a bad idea to have unapproved UN treaties being imposed on local governments. So I'm very much opposed to Agenda 21. The Law of the Sea Treaty, I think, has been written badly, creates a new international body, and I think limits our ability to use our strength at sea. We are the most powerful and most successful seagoing nation in the world, and I think we very much do not want to give up control of the oceans. We're already about to get in a big argument with China because they're arguing that their 200-mile economic limit is actually their 200-mile right of inspection. And they'd like to say no U.S. ship can, historically it's either 3 miles or 12 miles, but it has never been 200 miles. And so I think it's very dangerous for us to sign agreements that give third world countries and international organizations abilities to control our future. Okay, gentleman right here, let's see if we...
There's been, as an educator, there's been a big firestorm over education, specifically coming out of No Child Left Behind with value-added assessment, and we've been fighting that in Louisiana over the past several weeks. I wanted to know, while the economy is important, I mean, certainly we all are affected by the economy and homeland security. What are your plans for education as far as No Child Left Behind and your policy?
I think No Child Left Behind has been a disaster. I think it leads to a national curriculum which will be written by the liberals. I think that it leads to teaching to the test, and I think it bureaucratizes education even more than it already is. I would like to shrink the Department of Education very dramatically back to being research only. I'd like to send all the powers back to the states and have the 50 states deal with it. I'd also I would take most of that power out of Baton Rouge, and I'd get it back down to the parishes and local school boards. I think the more you can get parents, teachers, and students to work together, and the more you can recenter power at that level, the better off you are. Teaching at its best is a missionary vocation. You cannot bureaucratize it. When you do, you kill the very spirit of learning.
Mr. Speaker, I would like to pose this question to serve also as an instructive moment for President Obama. Louisiana College for 106 years has been based on biblical truth. We're a religious organization. We've been told recently that we must throw away a basic tenet of our institutional belief, which is the sixth commandment, thou shalt not murder. We know that President Obama does support the murder of the unborn. We do not. We serve at the altar of life, not the altar of death. We have filed suit against Obamacare in order to draw a line in the sand that our First Amendment right as a religious institution has been not threatened but violated. We will close the institution before we will support abortifacients and abortion-causing procedures as mandated by President Obama. What is your position regarding an institution like ours that's built on religious freedom and truth, who is unwilling to have a president who supports that murderous position to try to influence our religious beliefs?
Well, I think you put your finger on the greatest long-term threat to this country. We were based on religious liberty. We're based on our rights coming from our Creator. We're based on those rights being unalienable. What Obama stands for is a radical revision of America, in which we become a secular European socialist country, in which the government dictates everything. The key to the movie that Clist and I did on Pope John Paul II was his teaching that no government could come between God and man. And the Polish people rose up and for 10 years fought the dictatorship. You know, and I remind people regularly, this was a dictatorship which was so anti-religious that it would not allow school prayer. Now imagine a government that was so anti-religious it would not allow school prayer. You know, I mean, we look at the Polish communist dictatorship and then we look at modern American judges, many of whom are anti-religious bigots. And they seek to impose on the rest of us their value system. And Obama is simply the personification of a trend that's been here for 50 years. And I think this is this is why, as Calista said earlier in introducing me, this is the most important election of our lifetime. I mean, if now that we know how radical he is, and now that we know how incompetent he is, and now that we know that he's given us the worst economy since the Great Depression, he's given us the highest gasoline prices in history, he's built up trillions and trillions of dollars of deficit for our children and grandchildren, if he can get reelected with all of that, you can't imagine how radical his second term will be. And these are people who, in the end, are opposed to us living our religion. They don't mind if we worship 1 hour a week. They just don't want us to believe it. And if we believe it and we try to live it out, we are their mortal enemies. And that's just a fact. This is also the president who voted for legalizing infanticide as a state senator in a very specific case in Illinois, and said that the abortion doctor, if they had to then kill the baby after the baby was born, if the baby survived the abortion, the doctor had no risk if the doctor then killed the baby. Well, that's just plain out infanticide. And it just gives you a sense of how radical Obama's personal views are on these issues. And he's surrounded by people who are equally radical. And I think every religious institution in America that feels imperiled has to say to everybody that is associated with that institution, your alumni, your students, your faculty, everybody, that the election this fall is life and death for religious liberty in America. And I think it's just that clear. Thank you all very, very much. Let's start over here. Okay.